Hey folks, how's it going? Dr. Spin. Eclectic album reviews and gentle musical meanderings. Yet another album appetizer post for you. Way over halfway there. We're sort of in the home stretch now, trying to cover 48 albums. And these albums are going to be the ones that sort of set the stage for what I'm listening to in 2022. So let's go and get started on it. First one up today is Sufjan Stevens, The Ascension. I'm not familiar with Sufjan Stevens up until very recently. Of course, I've seen his name spoken of very highly in critical circles for years, for a very long time. But this one had gotten positive reviews throughout the course of last year, so finally I sort of relented and decided to check it out. Now, one of the things that Sufjan Stevens is very well known for is being a pretty ambitious songwriter. You know, he was rumored for a while to like make an album over every state in the U.S., you know, and of course after two albums worth, it kind of maybe was too big of a project. And my idea about Sufjan Stevens in the past, having never really listened to his music before, is probably diluted pretty seriously. His album is very, very electronic in its nature, and very dreamlike and very floating. The textures on this album are thick and luxurious and just really make you feel like over the course of the album just kind of floating on the cloud. If I was going to relate Sufjan Stevens' work, especially in this example, to something that you know I grew up with, I would have to put him in the same sort of league as Peter Gabriel. He has that same kind of art rock sensibility to what he does, but also is ambitious in a similar way. But on top of that, he's also very sincere. I think that Sufjan Stevens is pretty open here about what he's trying to accomplish with this album as far as the lyrics and the concept goes. Okay, next up is Cardiacs on Land and in the Sea. Lots of kind of really niche prog fans point at the Cardiacs as a really important group. And I think it's interesting because the Cardiacs kind of don't fit in the classic paradigm of what progressive rock is, especially when you get past 1980, because in the 1980s you really start talking about neo-prog, and a lot of neo-prog was connected to like Genesis and more classic ideas of progressive rock. But there's also this sort of dark side of progressive rock, this whole vein of darker, weird progressive rock. I would say the Cardiacs kind of like take all the surreal and weird parts of Genesis and Pink Floyd, like including like Syd Barrett Pink Floyd, that far back, and puts Peter Hamill from Van de Graaff Generator, like he's not really the lead singer, but the lead singer definitely has a connection to Peter Hamill's voice. But with the energy and the punk rock attitude of like Fishbone. Now, why these guys really aren't bigger on the prog pantheon is kind of beyond me. Again, beyond the fact that a lot of their albums are kind of hard to get hold of now, which is why it's taking me so long to get into them. Most of their albums are out of print. I finally found one that wasn't like exorbitantly expensive. I think that if we had a more clear lineage between like Van de Graaff Generator and what the Cardiacs are doing here, you'd also kind of look at bands more clearly like Mr. Bungle and Faith No More and even like John Zorn to a degree and see how they connect to progressive rock a little bit more clearly. But when you get to 1989, like that it diverged so much that from the classic idea of what progressive rock is, that I think that the Cardiacs kind of got lost in the mix, which is too bad. This is an amazing disc with all the detail and the surprises of a great progressive rock album, but with almost the transgressive attitude of a punk rock group. Okay, now next up is Tim Reynolds and Greg Howard's Sticks and Stones. This 1987 album was one of the very first albums that was recorded by Greg Howard, stick player Greg Howard. And it's a funny story about this disc because I got a hold of this disc whenever I was doing kind of close studies on the Chapman stick in like the early, late aughts, early teens. And listened to it some at the time, but then somehow the disc and the case got separated around that time. And I kept on finding the case show up in my desk drawers at work. But lost the disc, and recently in my recent move this summer, then found the disc, but then had packed away the case. So literally this last year, the two finally met together, and it's a disc that I had barely even listened to back in the day. So cracking it back open sounded like a great thing to do it. Now, despite its humble beginnings as like a tape-based album, and even the first early versions of the album were duped on a single deck recorder, you know, one at a time. It was later remastered for CD. Its clarity and the sound quality on the album is really phenomenal. And Dirt definitely doesn't sound like something that was recorded in somebody's bedroom in 1987. Very impressive from a sonic standpoint. And finally, I got Parliament's Mothership Connection. Now, year before last, in 2020, I kind of cracked open Funkadelic's Maggot Brain and really started trying to think a little bit more about George Clinton and his bigger picture of what he was accomplishing in the late 60s and 70s. And of course, Maggot Brain was not what I expected at all. What I expected was more like what I found on the Mothership Connection. Now, if you want to go out and get a Parliament Greatest Hits, save yourself the trouble, just go get this album, because most of what you know from Parliament is on this recording. Hugely influential, super essential for kind of the overall black narrative and for slang creation in the 70s, and also musically very solid excursion with despite it being kind of a weird, goofy feeling album, solid musicianship all the way through. Mothership Connection is definitely more structured and more song-based than Maggot Brain was, and a little bit less raw overall. It's got a lot more polish. And looking over all of George Clinton's oeuvre, this is a very pivotal moment and a classic, classic album, and one that's a lot of fun to listen to. And if you have people over and you want to put something on that will spark like a memorable chord for them, this would be an album to do that with, okay? That's all I got for you guys this week. So like and subscribe and share it out with your friends. Also follow me over on Spotify. I'll be putting tracks up from these posts. And until I see you next time, I'll catch you on the flip side.